أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الحمد لله رب العالمين وبه نستعين على أمور الدنيا والدين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي. سبحانك لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم. نويت تعلم وتعليم ونفع والانتفاع وتذكر وتذكير والإفادة والاستفادة والحث على التمسك بكتاب الله وسنة نبيه صلى الله عليه وآله وصحبه وسلم والدعوة إلى الهدى والدلالة إلى الخير ابتغاء وجه الله وقربه وثوابه. أما بعد، الحمد لله، all praise and thanks be to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Salawat and salam upon our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. My dear brothers and sisters, ladies and gentlemen, alhamdulillah, we continue our sharing sessions today with a new topic, different to what we did last year. Last year we shared about verses from the Quran, tafsir. And last we shared at the beginning of December was about Surah Yusuf and how Surah Yusuf, containing the stories about the life in chronological order of Prophet Yusuf alayhi salam, is a surah which is full of lessons and motivations, especially for us going through hardships in our life. And it served also as a surah that gave motivation and strength to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam when he was facing hardships in his da'wah. That surah was descended by Prophet by Malaika Jibril alaihi salam, and that surah contains stories about the hardships that Prophet Yusuf alaihi salam went through and the happy ending that comes, the ease that comes after the hardship that Prophet Yusuf alayhi salam persevered. So we continue this year with a new title, a new topic, which is pertaining to marriage, pertaining to nikah, pertaining to everything relating to marriage. And inshallah, I will also attempt to address questions, should there be questions and inquiries about nikah on the whole. So if not today, maybe in the future classes, you can also perhaps forward your question to the mosque office and they can relay to me the questions, and inshallah we will share about it in our class. And today we begin with the first lesson on marriage. Why this topic was chosen? Because it is such an important aspect of our life. It needs to be addressed, it needs to be talked about, it needs to be shared, and we have to have some information about it. It is not something, especially for couples beginning their journeys in marriage, they have to know that the life that we lead, they have to know that the times that we live in are confusing times. We no longer have lives that our parents, we no longer live in times of our parents. Back then, which I'm sure most of you are aware of, people had more perseverance, people had more patience. And I think the challenges that couples faced before definitely are different than what couples today face, especially with the free mixing that is available nowadays everywhere. People can be on bed, be in bed with their partners, but their minds, their fingers are in communication with other people. People have problems with their spouse, they can share their problems with the spouse of someone else. That is something which is worrying and becoming quite of a norm nowadays. And this is only one of the challenges that couples face, which unfortunately is something that we need to address, as I said earlier, because the rate of divorce in our community, and especially as a Muslim community, and also a Malay community, which is known to have strong family ties and filial piety and strong family values, the rate of divorce is very, very high in our community. Just for those who are already not already aware of the situation, almost 50% of the number of marriages in a year, or for example, in the whole of Singapore, in comparison with other communities, in percentage, the highest divorce rate is our community. It seems that we have quite a few problems in our community. Even the amount or the percentage of our brothers convicted in prison is extremely high as compared to people from other communities. And I'm not sure also what is the problem, but what we can do is at least learn or have basis in our religion in what we do. Marriage is something that someone needs to prepare for, because nowadays young people, our friends, our children maybe, the bulk of their preparation and their worries in going into marriage is worrying about the marriage or the specific occasion or the event of nikah on the day of nikah and marriage itself. Sometimes people are worried. Usually I get some questions. People will ask, what do I say on the day of nikah? How do I recite? Do I have to recite any du'as? What do I have to say on that day? Because I will be nervous. And can you please provide some text for me so I know what to recite, the akad nikah, and so on and so forth. And how about the mahar, the mas kawin, and how about the hantaran, the gift, the monetary gift? Do I have to declare that? And what is the amount of hantaran? What is the amount of hantaran? What is this and what is that? All the questions are relating to the day of nikah itself, which is unfortunately the case nowadays. Even in among the preparations that couples have to go through, I usually strongly advise my brothers, please make sure, or especially if you are parents here nowadays, parents here today, if people want to get married to your daughter or your son is about to get married, please strongly encourage them to attend pre-marriage course, even if they do not see it as beneficial. Because as I said, the situation today, we need, couples need all the help they can get. People can spend $10,000 for hantaran or monetary gift for marriage. They can spend $5,000 on videography itself, only on the videography and photography. It's around $4,000 to $5,000. They can spend hundreds of dollars to rent a vehicle for the day itself, for a car and tow rush. They can pay up to $20,000 to $30,000 for the walima to give food, invite people, and most of them they do not even know to their marriage. These are thousands and thousands of dollars. They can take leave from work to taste the food that they are going to serve people they do not know on the day of marriage itself. To try the clothes that they will wear on the day of nikah. But when we ask them to please attend a pre-marriage course, they will say, come up with Not all of them, of course, but some of them. They come up with lots and lots of excuses. No, sorry, I cannot afford. It costs $130. It is so expensive. I'm not free on this day itself. I'm not free. I cannot come. I don't attend this course. This clash with this, this and that. But that is the problem today. People do not see the importance. And the important aspect of marriage is the things that you face every day, the challenges that you face, and what preparations that you have in facing the challenges every day. It's not, you know, you mean for you go and apply for a job, they will ask you for your qualifications. You have to have this skill, you have to have this set of skills, you have to have certain knowledge relating to the job that you are applying for. You have to have some certification relating to the requirements that you need to have in taking this job. And the job is 9 to 5 or 40 or 44 hours or 45 hours a week. But your marriage is 24/7 and it will last the rest of your life. So at least there is something that you have to learn about before going into marriage itself. And it's not fair for your couple if you go into marriage and you have no basic knowledge of marriage. And basic knowledge of marriage is not simply the rulings, what is halal and what is haram. And having religious preparation for the marriage is not simply to learn about the salat, which is also an unfortunate thing. Because I sometimes interview couples who are applying for marriage. Some of the questions I ask is that, how is your salat? How is the recitation of the Quran? How is your relationship with the Quran? How is your ibadah? While it is none of my business, but it's actually is my business to know and to advise couples that in going into marriage, you are going into something that requires a lot of preparation, because shaitan, one of the main missions of the shaitan is to break up Muslim families. There is a hadith in which it is related that the minions of Iblis, they report their activities. I have did this and this, I have did this and this, and what have you done? I have did this and this. And the one that earned praise, the highest praise, was the shaitan that reported, I have managed to separate a marriage. I have managed to make this couple, so-and-so couple, divorced. And you see, these are the challenges that couples have to realize, the importance of these things that they face every day in marriage. And this is one of the objectives of our weekly classes, is to share as much as possible about marriage and address probably questions that you have, which unfortunately also, as I said earlier, it is my own estimation of my own exposure to some people, is that 1 out of 2 persons who apply for marriage do not practice salat or do not know how to recite the Quran. And it is supposed to be something that is surprising, but unfortunately it is not. People are so far away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, while only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can give you happiness in marriage. It's only Allah, but you go into marriage and you spend thousands and thousands of dollars on things that last for one day, but you do not even want to spend $200 or $300 on a premarital course. You do not want to spend time to become close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. These are the things that you should already have made it ready before you go into marriage. Because some people say, okay, inshallah, after marriage, we will go attend class. After marriage, I will learn about the Quran. No, after marriage, you will have no time to do anything else at all. If you have children, you will be blessed by children. You will have no time at all to do this and do that. You will be very busy. So things to prepare our children with, my dear brothers, who are parents, who have children going into marriage, please make sure that before they go into marriage, they already have a good relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala before they go into relationship with another person that they will share the rest of their lives with. So today we will share, it's a bit of an introduction, so we'll just share a bit about marriage in Islam. It is something we have to realize that nikah in Islam is not it's not simply a ritual that we go through and then we go through our lives as per normal, as if nothing happened. It's just a change of status. It is more than that. It is something that brings us closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam says it fulfills half of our religion. Observe how the aqd of nikah, simply when someone says, I accept the nikah of so and so, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam says it fulfills half of their religious obligations. It fulfills half of your religion. It means fulfills half of your religious obligation towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It shows that it brings you closer to Allah. It is compulsory that marriage becomes something that brings you closer to Allah. If not, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam would not have given much importance in this marriage thing. It's not simply a ritual that you forget about, or you just simply the memories comes in pictures and videos that you do not even look at most of the time, which you spend thousands for. It's something that occurs on a daily basis, the importance of having the necessary preparation. It fulfills half our religion. Observe how the nikah, simply by saying you accept the nikah, you accept the responsibility and burdens of a husband, of a father, is put on your shoulders. Simply by saying, I accept the nikah and so, you accept all the burdens and responsibilities, and the doors to sin are closed. Your relationship with your partner, with your spouse, once she becomes your wife, that is your tawbah, that is your repentance for the sins that you have committed, probably if you did commit any sins with your spouse before you go into marriage. That is a tawbah. So it closes the door of sin. That means that it opens the door of mercy to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It should be something that brings you closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If not, marriage does not serve its purpose. If you do not realize this very, very important point, that marriage is something that brings you closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the first advice of marriage. It is something that should be something that brings you closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you do not realize this, realize now that it should be the thing that brings you closer to Allah. Because one of the victories that the shaitan have is by breaking up your marriage, is that it brings you farther away from Allah. And statistics I have heard that children who grew up who are from broken families, divorced parents, usually end up worse off than children, usually, most of the time. This is according to statistics. Most of the time, children from broken families have a hard time in their lives, and they are easily or more easily fall into difficulties and fail when facing challenges in life. Especially when they have no relation with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The condition for Allah to help you is that Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Ihfadillaha yahfadhka." Safeguard Allah, which means safeguard your relationship with Allah. Protect the religion of Allah by fulfilling your obligations with Allah. Have a good relationship with Allah. That is the precondition for someone to receive the safeguarding or the protection of Allah for your relationship, for your wealth, for your health, for your life. Ihfadillaha yahfadhka. Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, protect, safeguard our responsibility, safeguard the deen, the religion of Allah. Allah will protect you. What more protection do you need other than that? Protection of Allah, Allah will help your relationship. Allah will help you in this, Allah will help you in that. Make Allah your intention. Make Allah in front of you. You will find that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be in front of you. figuratively, metaphorically speaking, of course. Make Allah your intention, and Allah will be right in front of you. Allah will take care of you. What more care and protection do you need other than that? So that is why I always emphasize this ibadah, this salat, is not something that is unrelated with our lives. This is also something that is not from Islam. This idea and this notion that religion is our self-practice and our own lives is separate from our religion. Sometimes this idea is thrown about and we do not understand where it comes from. It comes, or it is a philosophy of non-Muslims, where they put their religion in practice 5 times a day, and your daily life, religion has nothing to do with that. That is something that is not from Islam, brothers. In Islam, Allah is everything in our lives. Our ibadah, our specific acts of worship, is part of our responsibilities as Muslims. Islam shapes our thought. Islam shapes the decisions that we make. The importance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is reflected in the decisions that you make in your daily lives. It affects your worldview. It affects your understanding of things. It is something that your relationship with Allah is 24/7. It's not only in prayers. It's not something in your specific or your private practice. It is something that is contrary to the point that we have said. So marriage is something that is very much related to our religion. It is something very much that is related to our practice of Islam in our relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because love, which people associate with our partners and spouses and families, is something that is mentioned and reminded by Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He said, Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he mentions about love, he makes it together, he partners it with iman. In a hadith, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, La yu'minu ahadukum, you do not believe, which alludes that you do not have strong faith. Hatta akuna, until I become ahabba ilayhi, until I become the most beloved to him, to the believer, the most beloved to him, more beloved than his own parents, more beloved than his own child, more beloved than his own spouse. In the hadith, a wife is not even mentioned. Prophet Muhammad said, until I become the most beloved to him, more beloved than his love towards his child, min waladihi wa walidihi, and also his parents, wa nasi ajma'in, and all mankind, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be the first in our hearts. And then Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam will be the first in our hearts. Only then our relationship with our spouses will make sense. Because where the first thing about marriage is that we have to realize, people say you have to be just, you have to be adil, you have to have adala, you have to be fair, you have to be just. To be just is to make sure you have to know things are at their rightful place. So where does marriage lie in our lives? It's something that changes our lives, of course. But where and how is something that makes us closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Where does it lie in our daily lives as a Muslim? It belongs under our love and under our faith in Allah and Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. To explain this further, for example, someone wants to marry someone. A man falls in love with someone and he wants to marry her. In a religious understanding, this is of course a good thing. But behind that, the intentions need to be correct. There are a lot of things related to this that we have to understand that, inshallah, we will explain in the upcoming weeks. But one of the reasons that people say they marry is because love at first sight. Now, what does love mean? Love at first sight, what does this indicate? There are two things two words that people throw about marriage or before marriage, that love, and the other one is desire. Which one is it? Is it love or is it desire or is it interconnected? When people say love at first sight, is it a Muslim phrase? Where did we take this? How this understanding comes about, love at first sight? Well, it is something that is part of our human nature, is to love and to like things that we see. Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam reminds us that this is, of course, part of human nature. So he says there are four reasons that a woman is married for. She is married for her wealth, or because of her noble lineage or ancestry, because of her beauty. Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam addresses that these are the reasons that people get married, and religion also. And the point to note is that Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, in his mentioning of this hadith, lidiniha, religion is mentioned last, probably because usually people marry and this is at the back of their mind. The first, what is his love at first sight? Because that means that it is something that comes about from their desires first, not their faith. It is part of it. But you say, why do you love someone because at first sight? In Islam, Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says about first sights. What did he say? About first sight, Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, Nazra sahmun min sihami syaitan. This sight of someone that is not from our mahram, that causes us so-called to love or fall in love or something like that. Sahmun min sihami syaitan. It is an arrow from among the arrows of shaitan. People call this shaitan cupids. Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says that they are shaitan. Sahmun min sihami shaitan. They are an arrow from among the arrows of shaitan, which causes someone to look at something that is haram and causes him to shaitan tells him that this is love. And why is this harmful? Because most of the time, this so-called love will cause someone to commit a sin towards. So there are things that we have to explain, inshallah, in further detail. And what I have explained also needs further explanation. So I hope there has been no misunderstanding of the points that I have made, inshallah. Anything that is not clear will be clarified in the coming weeks in the following classes, inshallah. Aqulu qawli hadha wa astaghfirullah al-azim li wa lakum wa astaghfirullah min qawlin bil amalin. Subhanakallahumma bihamdika ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta astaghfiruka wa atubu ilaik. Wa sallallahu ala sayyidina Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi sallam. Walhamdulillahirabbil alamin. Wassalamu alaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.